Oh, poor little guy. Okay, that'll work out.
So, this test is 7-4 through chapter 8. Remember, 7-1, that counting section was on the last test. So, this has got all the probability stuff. Holy crap, what the heck happened? So you got all this stuff here?
Bless you. All of that, yes.
Oh, yes. What does or basically mean? No.
That was the add.
Add. Right? Because we have to say, well, you could be a woman, or you could be a jazz lover, or you could like lima beans, or, and every time I say or, I'm increasing the number of people that could. So it adds and adds and adds. That's why it makes sense that the formula is basically addition. But if it just stopped there, I'm going to make mistakes. Because I would have counted anybody in both of these groups. So I would have counted them twice. Cool. And then we go probability of A given B. Then mathematically through this and through some other things that we did, we discovered that the formula for A and B can actually be written in two different ways. It's basically multiply these two things, but you have to adjust the second dude. Right, so probably of A happening and then B happening, but given that A already happened. So if I do without replacement cards, this is going to adjust a little bit because I got one less card. Or probability of B, centrality of A given B, those will come out the same, believe it or not. Doesn't matter which way you do it. Cool. And then you've got, let's see, then we get into chapter 8. And I would understand if you don't even want to write, let's see, we didn't use that symbol. If you don't want to write this down, because you know how to find the average, but if you want it, there it is. All right, so this is a nice little introduction to the summation symbol. That sigma, that capital sigma. And then you've got this dude here. That is the what? Not quite yet, because I haven't taken a square root yet. So this is the
variance.
I love it. All right, so it's not as important to know the word, but just realize, if you want to, you could put another formula down, which is S equals the square root of this. So calculate what this is, and of course I got a square root to kill those squares. And why do we have to square to kill the negatives? Right? That sounds like an old song about the old lady who swallowed a fly. You never heard that old song? There was a lady who swallowed a fly. I think she'll die. But she swallowed a spider to kill the fly. All right, forget about that. Sorry. It's nothing to do with math. It was just a side note.
Oh, it's a kid's song.
It's a kid's song, yes.
That's why.
Sure, you can still know about kid stuff even if you're older. It's crazy. All right, especially if you have kids, then you know all kinds of stuff. Okay. Anything else you want to have on that formula sheet? Was there anything else? I don't think there was anything else. Now's the time to ask for. The answers? That would be really useful. Oh, yeah. What about, we can put mid-range down there, right? You can put mid-range down there. This is one of the few words you can have on your formula sheet because it's
Doesn't have a symbol. Poor little dude.
Mid range is high plus low divided by 2.
All right, cool. I think that's it.
All right.
All right, you guys will just accept that. Good. Okay, so today is review day, so it's wide open to whatever you want to focus on. Yes?
Okay, so on the practice test, D was confusing.
Part D?
C, E,
N. For number one, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know whether to do the whole thing and subtract the numbers on the whole list.
We'll do another example. Does everybody got what they want from here? Like some guys are like writing and saying, yes, and you're writing like, I don't think so. All right, let me just erase this part.
So let's do another example.
And like I said, on the practice test, I actually made it a little harder, but you can go by the examples we did. On the actual test, I'll give you
this, because I'll be just so unbelievably nice.
You've got the formula, so you have to know how to use it. But I'll remind you about what columns you need to make.
Oh,
what? What's up?
What'd you say?
I'll give you this on the test, right? So you'll just have to fill it in, and then know how to use the formula correctly. I like it. So let me do a different set of data because I got this on the answer key already. Let's see. Let's do. Trying to make the mean come out kind of nice. So real quick, would you say this is very spread out or not very spread out?
Very spread out.
I'd say it's pretty spread out. Right? And it's a relative thing, because I could have made this $38 billion, and then it would be stupid spread out. The word stupid is a good adjective. So take a minute, figure out the mean. I got to know the mean before I can do anything, right? So you got to know these symbols, which is why it's not a bad idea to put this formula down, so at least you remember the symbol. This means the mean. Right? Specifically, it's the sample mean. So figure out the mean for me real quick. Yes.
She said something.
She did. You're going to keep going anyway. So, yeah.
Yeah, I got the same thing.
All right. Because when you add these up, what's the sum of x?
70.
And then x bar is the sum of x divided by n, so it's 70 divided by 5.
14.
Which is 14. I like it. Oh, yeah. All right. Now, you know, the mean is 14. So what goes here?
14.
Yeah, in this row, what's x?
X is the sum.
In this row, what is x?
2.
2. And what does this say to do?
Right.
Each x minus the mean. So it'll be 2 minus
14.
14. Which is?
12.
Negative 12. Negative 12, yeah. How are we doing so far? I love you guys. I love students. It's like you guys could kick ass in poker, man. Shit. How you guys are like this? How you guys doing?
Terminator.
You're like exactly at zero on the emotional scale, right? I have zero emotions to show you. Which one?
So then 4 minus 14?
Negative 10.
Negative 10. 9 minus 14? Negative 5. 17 minus 14? 3. 38 minus 14?
Oh, that's 24. Yeah.
All right. Now, how do I check to make sure I'm on the right track?
You're gonna, it's gonna...
Zero.
Yeah, if I add all of these, and please let this make sense. We did a symmetric problem earlier, so there was a positive 3 and there was a negative 3. But here you can see there's more negatives than positives, right? Because one of the positives is big. There's 27, and then there's negative 27. Do you guys see that? So there's equal amounts of negative as positive. Of course there is. That's what the mean does. So the sum of my x minus x bar is 0 the way it's supposed to be. And of course, that's why we squared things. That's why the next column is squared, so that I don't always just get frickin' 0. Right?
Like, oh, it's a 0, and then you have to...
Don't get me started, because I could just unleash on you with the history. I've done a lot of research into the history of statistics. You do not want to listen to me drone on about it, but you should. There's Carl Pearson, there's Fisher, and all these early guys. Anyway, it all started about researching how to use soil the best in agricultural kind of stuff. That's where that's one of the first uses of statistical analysis. Anyway. So here, I square these. So 12 squared?
24.
Squared?
No.
144. Now just double, squared, yeah. And be real careful. All of these numbers have to be, how would you describe what they have to be? They all have to be positive, because you're squaring real numbers. You're going to have a positive. And one of the biggest mistakes is people leave the negative here, and they get all kinds of weird-ass answers. Complex standard deviations. Holy shit. Negative 10 squared. 5, negative 5 squared. 3 squared. 24 squared.
576.
So like. So the sum of x minus x bar squared. Do you guys really understand? This column is the x minus x bar squares. What's the formula need? The sum of x minus x bar squares. So all you gotta do is add these numbers up, and that's what's gonna go on the top of the formula. That's what it needs. The sum of these. And what's the sum of those? 76. Who is it?
854.
Sounds about right. 854, yeah. So I know as a student, you can sometimes get so wrapped up in the minutiae of the math that you forget the idea. How far is every data point from the mean? We had to square just to kill the negatives. Right? And what are we trying to create? We're trying to create a number that tells me how far the data points get from the mean on average. That'll be the spread, the average distance they get away from the mean. If they don't get very far away from the mean on average, the data is not very spread out. If they do get very far away, the data is very spread out, the number should be bigger. So here, where does this number go? Whenever I ask a question like that, I'm always like, I'll tell you where to put that number, Ms. Waller. No, you stop that.
So it's over. The numerator over.
I love it.
The
so that's the sum of the x minus x bar squares. You don't plug stuff in here. That doesn't make any sense. That is the sum of all of these. You've already plugged stuff in here. There they are. And that is the sum of all of them. So replace this with 854, because that's what the hell it is.
And you divide by?
And divide by? 4, because there's 5 data points minus 1.
And you do that?
Yes, 2, 13.5. Maybe.
2, 1, 3.5.
Okay. What is that now?
That.
Yeah, I haven't square rooted yet. That's the variance. I don't have the standard deviation.
That's the variance?
That is the variance. Because we haven't done what? We haven't square rooted it yet. That's what the symbol is telling me. Hey, dude, you haven't square rooted. It's not standard deviation yet. So the standard deviation is going to be the square root.
So I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
From the problem that I asked you, do you just leave the variance as it is? Just leave it there?
And then square root it to get the standard deviation. That's what we're about to do.
But you said that's the variance. Never mind.
So, yeah, exactly. So I ask you for the range. The range is just high minus low. The variance.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And then you get the variance, and then take the square root to get the standard deviation.
And that's
the,
okay.
So this right here is the variance.
Okay.
Found that. Now I need to take a square root to find the standard deviation. And what's the square root of 213.5?
I don't know, Jeff.
I don't know
either. If I did it right, it's
14.611. Sounds about right. 14.611. You guys agree? You concur?
Wait. Where is that? Yeah, I think.
Oh, okay. That's sad. I give it to you. But now, real quick, let me just look. The mean was 14, right? Right? That's 5 away, that's 12 away, that's 24 away. So the average distance came out to be 14. That makes sense. That sounds about right. That number tells me the average distance that all the data points get away from the mean. That's what that number tells me. That's why it's the spread. Yes?
Okay, so why did the teacher tell me to find the variance and then subtract that from each of the numbers on top? Like the 14?
What teacher told you to do that?
I mean, not teacher, the tutor in the tutoring room. And I was like, are you sure I'm supposed to do this?
They need some help.
And then,
and
I was like, what the heck?
You need to, yeah.
And then that's why I was like, it's so far off from what I'm learning, because I told him what you did right there. And he's like, no, but you just got to get the variance and check it. But it's so easy. I'm like,
all right, that's, the student needs some help.
Okay.
Whoever that was, if you can remember who it was, in fact, it's like Denny's, they have their pictures there, so you can just circle them. And you should say, I found out this tutor told me something wrong about statistics, you know, and then, right? And when I was in charge of the Mass Study Center, statistics, now, real quick word about statistics. We expect the tutors to be able to tutor statistics after they've had one statistics course, do you understand? So on one level, yes. I mean, how many statistics courses do we offer at Grossmont? How many levels?
Two.
No.
One.
There are several different level one statistics courses. There's a stat 215, I mean, a psych 215, a soc 215, a econ 215, I think nowadays, and blah, blah, blah. They are all 160. They are all level one. Right? So on one level, the students, to make sure that they're ready for statistics tutoring, they have to do this MyMathLab certification and pass all the tests in there at a certain level to show that they're ready to help people out. It sounds like this person needs a refresher course, right? Because this is a very important topic that all the tutors for statistics should be able to handle, period. So it sounds like this person needs a refresher, so if nobody speaks up about them, they're not going to get that refresher. So I desperately ask you to go back and fill any eval. Okay, well, if you look at the eval, maybe you'll remember the face.
Okay.
Or you just make a general statement. One of your stats tutors told me something very wrong about standard deviation, just to let you know.
Okay.
Right, and then hopefully the coordinator...
Well, there's another way to solve this. That's why I was just like, okay.
No. not like what you were saying, no. Yeah. Okay.
That's why I was like, I'm not going to do this work. I'm just going to tell you to help me.
Or you could ask him. Minutes office hours.
Yeah.
All right. So when I ask you to find the variance in the standard deviation, what's nice is you got to find this to get there anyway. You got to find both of them as you're working through it. And really, I mean, I desperately want you guys to understand, the formula was constructed to tell us the average distance from the center. So, and that makes sense to, that would be the spread of the data. That makes sense that that's how spread out the data is, right? So if I did, and we're not going to do it, but if I did another set of data that looked like this, is this very spread out?
No.
Nowhere near as spread out as that. So this guy's standard deviation should be much smaller than 14.6. If I had to guess, I'd say the mean looks to be about here, right? So it gets about 5 away there. I'd guess it to be maybe around 3 or something. I mean, that's just a quick guess. Who knows?
It's going to be much smaller because the spread is much smaller. They don't get as far away from the mean as this one does. This gets pretty far away from the mean. That's why a standard deviation came out so big. Right. Maybe. So it makes sense. I want to know the middle of the data and how spread out the data gets away from that middle. That's the two best little numbers for a summary of data. Yes?
And then for that one, could you use like the same information but for E?
Oh, okay. Here we go. You have to use that information. So, but I see what you mean. So up here. So let me keep this here. Let me get some room here somewhere. We don't need this anymore. Go away. So now part E. So this is like part D, but with different data. Part E, what percentage of the data falls within one standard deviation of the mean? So what was the mean?
One deviation.
The mean was one standard deviation.
Oh.
No, one deviation. I'm sorry if I sounded drunk. The mean was 14 here, right? So what's one standard deviation up? Where do I end up if I add?
So you subtract.
And I subtract.
By the
standard deviation. Standard deviation, exactly. Sorry, officers.
So, for A, I mean...
So if I go up one step, where do I end up? From the mean, go up a standard deviation. Add a standard deviation on top. Where do I end up? What's 14 plus 14? 28.611. And if I subtract... Not quite. Minus 14 is 0, minus 0.611 would be 0.389. Negative. If you don't trust me, just do it in the calculator.
I don't blame you. Do you write both of that? No. Both of those answers on
the... So let me ask you this. If I said, I want you to try to guess my weight within 5 pounds. So you could be above by 5 pounds or below by 5 pounds. That's what the word within means. Right, so within one standard deviation means the mean, one standard deviation up from it, and one standard deviation down from it. That's what within one standard deviation means. Right?
So
okay, yes, so definitely both. So how many data points do I catch in there? I catch all the way up to what? What's the only number I don't catch? 38. That's way up here, right? So there's 4 data points in here, 2, 4, 9, and 17. Those are all in there, right? And one of them's outside. So I caught 4 out of 5 data points. So what percentage is in there? 80%. 4 out of 5 is 80%. So let me ask you, the math involved there is not very difficult. It's just understanding how to apply it. So let's say these are ages of people somewhere, and I just ask you, what percent of the people here are between 5 and 16? Including 5 and 16, right? So how many? There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people. What percentage are between 5 and 16? Well, how many are between 5 and 16?
2.
All right, including 5 and 16. 1, 2, 3, 4?
4, 6.
4 out of 6. In fact, go back to frequency distributions. Isn't this basically what we did? You have a little class from 23 to 28 or whatever, and you just count how many fall in there. I'm refining out those numbers a different way. We're saying add a standard deviation, subtract a standard deviation, and then I get the two numbers that I count how many are in between there. So how do you do a frequency distribution? I would tell you 23 to 28, 29 to 34, blah, 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 blah. And then what would you put here? The number that falls between these two, right? How many fall between these two? So really, it's all we're doing. It's just that you have to come up with these numbers. How?
Oh.
put the mean, add a standard deviation, subtract a standard deviation, go count how many fall in there, divided by the total is the percentage that falls inside there. That's all. Okay, maybe.
For that one, when you got the, how you minus the 14.611,
yeah.
You basically minus it with the 14 to get the 0.380.
Yeah, 14 minus 14.611 would go below zero, right? Because it's a little more than itself I'm taking away. But you just do this in the calculator.
Calculator.
But it makes sense it's going to be below zero because I'm taking more away than I have.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I'm going to owe money.
Oh, okay.
It's like doing your IRS and going, oh shit, I owe this. I owe more than I have. Oh shit. Okay, that reminds me, I got to do my taxes. Okay. Anybody else need the practice test? Everybody got the practice test? Okay. Is that what?
I think that's going to the actual.
Oh, cool. You're doing pretty good. So let me ask you what seems like a silly question in preparation for a question I think there should be. How did I get 28.611? I added this to this, right? So how many standard deviations above the mean is this? One. So if I wanted to go two steps above the mean, I would say 14 plus two times this, right? So if you look at problem number two, that's all that one's asking, right? Start the mean and subtract so many if it's below.
E.
Number two. A, B. Number two. E is this. This is one E. But number two is talking about going down so many standard deviations, going up so many standard deviations. Okay, cool. So again, the thing with the statistics is the math involved is very minimal. In fact, if you're going to take statistics, there's barely any algebra in it, which is why so many people were so like, oh, goody, let's just cut algebra out entirely because you don't need it for stats. But I'm like, well, you just need freaking algebra, period, so stop it. Yeah, I said that. Anyway, so there's really not a lot. There's barely any algebra in statistics, but the concepts are what get people a little bit down, right? Give people some trouble. Hopefully the back went okay with all the probability stuff.
I had trouble with the examples. I didn't know how to write them
out. Oh, number five?
No. Wait. Maybe.
Well, that's the one I asked you to identify the sample and the population.
So you just put a population and you put like...
Yeah, exactly. So the sample for 5A would be... No, sample.
Population
322 telephones.
Yeah. And then
the population would be
all
the telephones at the factory.
Yeah.
I like it. Now, if you just say all telephones, I'm going to be a butthead. I'm going to say
even outside the factory. I mean, over in Sweden.
Yeah. So it's got to you got to be a little specific about your population. So all the phones at the factory.
And then B would be the same thing.
Yeah, B is the same thing. What part of B doesn't have a damn thing to do with the question? Somebody see that? What's the sample? Who did I talk to? In fact, I just tell you directly what the sample is. What is the sample?
Students.
No, that sounds more like a population. Yeah, 183 gross month students, right?
The
14%. Ah, see, the 14% doesn't have a damn thing to do with this question. 14% of a sample of, oh, so the 14% is what I did with my sample. So it has nothing to do with this question. The 14% is just, I looked at my list of people and I found 14% said that yes, they enjoy parking at Grossmont.
It's the best part of my day.
I'm like, that's weird. All right, whatever. Float your boat.
Okay.
Yes?
I know you explained this. I'm sorry, but how did you get on that chart right there? How did you get -0.38?
Oh, so I do 14 plus 14.611, and I do 14 minus 14.611. 14 minus 14 would be 0, and then a little bit extra takes me below. Well, actually, it would be -0.611. Whoever said that, I'm overthinking that. Thank you. It's just below 0. And the lowest data point I have is 2. Yeah, so it captures almost all the data except that one that's a little too big. It's above the top. Cool. Yeah. Okay. So the math that I did here was I said, what data point is one standard deviation above the mean? That's really how I got this. I want one standard deviation above the mean and one standard deviation below the mean. That's within one standard deviation, within one step. So what data point is one standard deviation above the mean? So I'm going to start at the mean. Since it says above, I'm going to add how many of these? Just one. So if I said what data point, so that's how I got 28.611. Bam. If I said what data point is 2.17 standard deviations above the mean. What's the only thing that here that would change? Start at the mean, go up. How many of these now? 2.17 of these. And again, what does of mean? Multiply, right? 2.17 of these. I like it. So then it's just mean plus that many of these. That's how you get that many steps above the mean. That's what you do. So if I said below, what would the only thing that changes here be? I'd be minusing because I want to go below the mean, right? I like it.
Above.
So let me do. Let me go ahead and give you guys the answer key. Aww.
I didn't work. I just wanted to check it on right.
No, no, no. I was about to say, I did a little extra work on 1B.
I was like, oh, I need to do it.
You didn't have to. I didn't say to make a histogram. But I just want to show you what it would look like. Doesn't that look like a bell curve?
That looks like a city.
It looks like a city. Like. It looks like a city flipping me off. Give me the verb. But we'll get past that. Yes?
I'm having trouble discerning the difference between dependent versus independent.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Because, I think that independent means that they're completely separate. So then it'd be like, say, for F, 6F, it'd be like, I think that they would be independent because they don't. In my mind, it means that, if they're independent, then they're completely separate, so they're not equal to each other. Or is it dependent?
Oh, okay, okay. You're there's a lot of probabilities that just happen to equal each other or not. So that has that's not the idea. The idea is how do they interfere with each other? Do they affect each other? There's only one probability formula that takes into account how things change if I know that one of them happened, and that's the given formula. So if the probability of A given B equals probability of A.
I realize something. Because right? When you say why or why not, you say no, isn't there not? Like there, so then, oh, because the question says, are they being dependent? Oh, okay, never mind. Yeah.
So if B happens, I really desperately, this is it right here. To be independent, if my getting to school is independent from your getting to school, that means if you don't get to school or you do, it doesn't affect me in any way, right? It doesn't change the probability that I get to school. That's what independent means in real life. So given that you got here, does that change the probability that I get here? No.
Maybe,
if you hit my car. Let's just assume everything went normally. Are you with me? So you were felt sick this morning. Does that change what how I feel? No, Emma. Right? I feel sorry for you, but I'm still going to come. So given that B happened, did A give a shit?
No.
No. The probability of A, given that B happened, if it's the same as what the probability of A was anyway, then obviously A doesn't care that B happened. They're independent from each other. A's like, oh, it's nice it happened. I don't give a shit. Right? It stays the same. So if these two are different, then that means that A cares that B happened if that changes. So look at number six. So I'm talking about second grade and Trump. Those are two things that seem to go together somehow. But, alright. I got all the good. So what I want to see is the probability of one of them, does it affect, if it happens, given that it happens, does it affect the other one? Now, have I already calculated any givens involving these two things? In this problem, have I calculated a given with Trump in second grade? Yes. Part E, right? I know the probability of Trump given second grade. So I want to compare that to the probability of Trump by itself. Do you see what I'm saying? So in part E, you calculate this. And in part B, you calculate this. So if the probability of Trump, whatever it was, if it changes, given that they're in the second grade, they are dependent. Because knowing one changes the other one, that makes sense, I call that dependent. If this number is the same, then obviously this situation didn't care that this happened. If it stays the same, they don't care. That makes sense that we call that independent. They don't care about each other at all. And your answers here for these two should be very different. Which should make sense. I would expect more eighth graders to know who the president is than second graders.
No.
Right?
Wait, I think... This is the problem. These are different. It's not the right. I think you wrote down the wrong thing. Because it's 0.44 repeating is for answering.
Oh, yeah. So it should say 0.2778. Yeah.
And you said no for saying Trump is independent.
So the probability of Trump given second grade does not equal the probability of Trump. So the probability Trump given second grade is 0.05. And the probability Trump, I just picked the wrong one out, should be 0.2778. Thank you.
So then, when you say...
So that does not
even... No, when it says why or why not, so then when you say answer no, meaning that they are independent?
Are being in the second grade and saying Trump independent?
No.
No. There you go.
So
they must, they're dependent.
Because when I answer these, I always say, yes, they are independent.
Well, you'd only say that if it's true.
Okay.
And in this one, it's not true.
That's where I'm fundamentally getting wrong. Because I'll write why are they independent? Are they not independent? I'll be like, yes, they are independent. And then I'll write down the answer, but then I'll get it wrong. You know what I mean? Or something.
All right, so
I'll say like.
All right, Shane.
Yeah.
How can you tell if they're independent if the given probability is the same as what it used to be?
I understand that they're not the same.
So therefore, they're not independent.
So then they. It's your.
Not really, no. So since these two numbers are not the same, since the probability of Trump changed, given that they were in second grade. Say again?
That these answers, that the probability of Trump, they are independent from each other.
Oh my gosh, okay. You're so focused on these two numbers themselves. No, no, no. What does this number represent? The probability of this, right? This number represents the probability of this. Does the probability of Trump change if I know that the student I'm talking to is in second grade? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, so they are dependent.
So they're dependent.
One event's probability is dependent on if the other events happened. That's what that means. If I know that they're in second grade, does it change the probability that they said Trump?
Okay.
Yes. So they are dependent. What's the probability they said Trump? Well, it depends on if they're in second grade or not, right? That's where the word dependent comes from for this.
Okay. So then it's dependent.
I like it. I like it. So a quick example of something that's independent, right? This might help a little bit. And I know that everybody likes cards, but go with me. Let's probably get a king out of a deck of cards. How many kings?
4 out of 52.
Which reduces to 1 out of 13. Is that cool? What's the probability I get a king, given that it's a club? Well, how many clubs are there? How many of each suit
is there?
There's 13 of each suit. So given that it's a club, so the bottom is going to be 13. Out of those clubs, because I know it's a club, so it can't be any other suits. How many kings are in the suit of clubs?
One.
These are the same. Therefore, king and club are independent events. If I tell you that it's a club that I'm holding, does it change the probability it's a king? No. They're independent. Because knowing it's a club, it's still the same probability that it's a king. Now, why does it make sense on another level? I threw out 3/4 of the deck. If I know it's a club, what can it not be?
It can't be a spade.
It can't be a heart. It can't be a diamond. I threw out 3/4 of the deck. And for each of those, I threw out a king. I threw out 3/4 of the king. So the ratio stayed the same. These are independent events. Knowing it's a club does not change the probability it's a king. So if I had a deck of cards and I pulled out a card and I said, do you think it's a king? Well, you got a 1 out of 13 chance it's a king. And I say, okay, it's a club I'm holding. That didn't do anything. That doesn't help you in any way. It doesn't tell you anything. It's still a 1 out of 13 chance it's a king. So that would be an example of independent events. Knowing one does not change the probability of the other one. They're independent from each other. One does not affect the other one. Here, knowing one affected the other one. This is dependent. Dependent on whether this happened or not. So does the probability of a king depend on if it's a club? No. It's not dependent because it stays the same. It stays the same. It doesn't depend on knowing if it's a club or not. I wouldn't say, what's probably got a king? And you would go, well, is it a club? That's not going to tell you. It's going to be the same number. It's not dependent on that answer. But if I said, some kid said Trump, and you go, well, were they in the second grade? Yeah, they're dependent. That changes the answer. That changes the likelihood of that. Probably going to be something that gives me early senility because I've never heard it quite put like that, the misinterpretation. So that could be happening to more of my students and they just didn't say it like that.
Yeah, I had the same.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, you're looking at the numbers and not thinking about the fact that they are different.
Like, if my thought was like, if they don't equal each other, then they must be independent because neither of them have the same.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this. If I was flipping a coin, right? You with me? And somebody, and one of you guys was rolling a die. And I said, okay, does getting a tail affect your rolling an odd number? What's probably the tail? 50%. It's probably an odd number on a normal die, 50%. They're equal to each other. That doesn't mean shit. It just happens to equal each other. Do you guys see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. So then, it'd be, if it was that problem, like the upper one with the kings and clubs and stuff, if they're equal to each other, then it's independent. If they're not equal to each other, it's dependent.
Think about it like this. If the probability doesn't change, I mean, think about it like that. That's the right way to think about it. You guys are thinking about it in a way that makes it seem opposite. If the probability doesn't change, then they're independent, right? If you don't change what you do because she's sick, you're independent from her health state. Do you understand?
Yeah.
And of course, if you don't know Jackie, then of course you are independent from that. You're not going to, I feel it disturbed. No. Right? Do you guys see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the probability you're going to come to class, if it doesn't change given that Jackie's sick, then your coming to class is not dependent on if Jackie's sick or not. You guys see that? So here, if I tell you it's a club, did the probability of the king happening change? No. So they are independent because he doesn't care if that's a club or not. Doesn't matter. It's the same. Here, if it's in the second grade, the probability of Trump goes way the hell down. Which makes sense. I would think that the second graders would get that answer wrong more often. Right? Okay. Maybe some adults who are in denial. I don't know. Okay, maybe. Okay. So anything else from the... Well, I'll let you guys look through the answer key. So that one should be 0.2778, not 0.4444. Too much and change where the middle is, then the spread's going to be really different. So round it to two places is good. It won't change it by that much. Yeah. So the thing, people get confused about the word and I don't blame you because the English language looks at the word and in two different ways simultaneously, right? And if English is anybody's second language, you know all too well that it's freaking weird. So in probability, we make it really clear what we mean by and. They must do both things. So and is always going to make the number smaller, right? So if I say the probability they're in second grade, so they have to be in second grade. And they have to have said my dad. Well, how many people do both things? They have to do both, not one or the other. That's or. How many people do both things? No? I can get the answer directly, right? 15 people do both. 15 people are in second grade and said my dad. 15 people said did both. I like it. Now, when I say both, though, people think you add the two groups together. No, no, no. You have to have done both. So if you wanted a scholarship and it said you have to have a GPA of 3.5 or higher, let's say at least a 3.5, I don't have the word or in there somewhere, and you have to be majoring in mathematics, right? So if you have only one of those true, you can't go for the scholarship, right? You have to meet both requirements. So you can't say there's 17 people because... Yeah, still, I haven't given you any information, so how many people could it be? All, any of them. So the bottom is still, what's the only time the bottom changes? If I give you information. So how many things match what I'm looking for? 15. Out of the total number, it could be whatever the total was, 36. Yes?
And two for on the front, one seed. I didn't know that two of the most could be two numbers. I thought how we can add those two and divide them by two.
Oh, no way. Yeah, so remember for mode, you can be bimodal, trimodal. Beyond that, I just say there's no mode, but yeah.
I got the mean one.
The mean?
Yeah.
I don't know either. So when you added them up, do you get 687?
That's good. My answer is 51.
Well, how'd you get that?
I don't know.
Okay. I think what you did was you found the middle before they were ordered, maybe, because it looks like 51 might be in the middle of the original data. But the mean is not the same as the median, and the median needs the data to be in order to make sense. If they didn't have to be in order, I can make anything I want it to be, the median. I can say the median price of a home in San Diego is $20,000, because I can just find a home that's $20,000 and put it in the middle of my data. There you go, right? Affordable house, San Diego. But it has to be in order to make sense, the median. And what's the mean another name for, by the way, if you're having trouble with that word mean?
Average.
Average. So when you see the word mean, just think what you normally think of as average. But that's just another name for the average. I like it. Yes.
So is it kind of different in that situation
now? No. The mean is the average, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because when you solve it, you were talking about how you multiply the standard deviation by the mean?
No. So let me ask you that. Let me say it a different way. Say I start at the number 10. I'm on the number 10 on this giant ruler laying on the ground. Right, so it's sort of like a big keyboard, just less interesting. Right, just a big ruler. And every step I take is 2 feet big, two. Right. So if I take two steps away from 10, above 10, where am I going to end up? Every step I take is 2 feet. So if I start at 10 and I take 2 feet, two steps, where will I end up? 14. Every step I take is 2. So that's why I call standard deviation steps, because it is how I step around the data. So if I start at 10, and every step I take is 2 feet, and I want to go 2 steps, I'm going to 10 plus 2 times 2. So what if I wanted to take 2.5 steps up? So 1, 2, where would I end up then? So I want to start at 10, and I want to go up. How many steps? Because each step is too big, right?
Right.
How many steps do I want? I just said I wanted to take
5.
2.5. And twice 2.5 is 5, plus 10 is 15. Which makes sense, because what's half a step? 1, in this case. Yeah, so 2 steps, and then half a step. So, this is acting.